buckle up and hold on. At our church, we love God. Make no mistake about that. At our church, we believe in God's radical, unconditional, and unwavering love for us. At our church, we believe that Jesus is God. We also affirm that you may or may not believe that Jesus is God. And we're not asking you to change your belief system before you attend our church. We're simply inviting you on a journey toward Jesus. For years, churches have placed a high priority on Jesus as the get-out-of-hell-free card. At our church, we place the highest priority on Jesus as a live life to the fullest invitation. At our church, we believe every person has a dream deep inside their hearts, and that God put that dream there, not for our glory, but for His. At our church, we're not concerned with where you've been, but where you're going. At our church, we believe that the Bible is God's Word. It is real, it is living, it is active. We believe that people who don't go to church anywhere are not the enemy. They are real people who need the perfect love that only God can give. And we believe that God gives us love through, of all people, us. At our church, we do not and we will not display a holier-than-thou attitude toward anyone. We are all broken people. But He is putting us back together. And finally, and most importantly, at our church, we believe that Jesus really lived, that He really died on a cross, and that He really rose again on the third day. And we cannot and we will not candy coat or water down that message, ever. Today, you've chosen to sit yourself in the middle of a very safe place to hear a potentially dangerous message. Welcome to our church.
Good evening, everybody. Welcome y'all to Lighthouse. I tell you, it's great to just have us all together tonight. It just feels, you know, one thing just kept coming to mind to me. It's just, tonight we're here, Bishop is here, but we're here to pull on heaven tonight. I'm here tonight, and when I pull on heaven, and then Bishop, when you start pulling on heaven, and Apostle, you start pulling on heaven, Pastor Terrence, and Pastor Chris, and Pastor Clyde, and we all come together as one, and we start pulling on heaven. Heaven responds. Praise That's God. Right. So we're going to get together. Let's stand on our feet and we're going to worship God. Amen.
Oh, today. Ooh. I told Lee, I said, Pastor Lee, I didn't know if it was my nerves or I'm just excited for what God is going to do for you tonight.
Yes.
Yeah. Because he's already here. I don't know about y'all, but I can feel it. You can just feel how he is because he is here. So as we go into praise and worship, God, just open up and just worship.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Your love.
lift your voice and say, worthy is, sing your holy, you are holy. Oh, are you Lord God? Are you? We cry out. Come on, tell him.
Sure, I've been gone for a long time. Thank you for being here. The Christmas season. Is it okay if we just talk tonight? I didn't hear very much response right there. Now, I can holler and spit this, or we can just talk. It's going to be the same stuff either way. I'm honored to be here tonight. Just before I say some things preliminary, I just felt this during the worship time. You know, Psalm 16 is one of my favorite psalms. I had a mentor in my life for many years. Some of you will know him. His name's Jack Hayford. And probably the most impactful time I ever experienced with him one day was when I was struggling over the condition, or maybe the position, that I was in my life. Anybody ever been somewhere and you felt like you were stuck? You felt like you've been sentenced to obscurity? Because I learned that when God hides you, can't nobody find you. It don't matter what marketing company you hire. If God decides to hide you, nobody can find you. And when God decides to reveal you, can't nobody hide you. And so we were talking one day, and Psalm 16, the writer makes this statement. He said, "My soul has said to the Lord, you are my Lord." For all of you that pay close attention to your Bible study, you'll realize the first word "Lord" there is in all capitals. And the second word "Lord" there has only got the first letter capitalized. And that's for a reason. The first word "Lord" that's all capitalized, he's referring to him as Jehovah, the self-sufficient, eternally existing, almighty God, the one nobody votes in, nobody can vote out, the one who's still God whether you believe in him or not. And he makes this amazing statement. I felt this in worship tonight for somebody in the room. He said, "My soul said to the eternal, self-existent, almighty God, you are my Lord." And the second word "Lord" there is the word Adonai. And it's the word for master, the one who rules my life. And he's about to reveal the benefits of having a master over your life. But you can't claim the rest of Psalm 16 if you've not settled verse number 2. Because there's a lot of people that would acknowledge he's God. They just don't give him permission to be their God. In other words, I don't mind showing up and watching him demonstrate his power. I just don't want him to disagree with my decisions. Can I say to you tonight that you have no hope of becoming mature in who God wants you to be if he can't disagree with you? So then he goes on to say, after he says that, and he says, "For you are my portion, and you are my cup. You maintain my lot. My lines have fallen to me in pleasant places." Wow. "You are my portion." Do you know what he's referring to? Is in the Old Testament, the true priest of the Lord didn't have an inheritance in the land. The Levitical priesthood had no inheritance. When the land was divided, the Levites didn't get any. He was their inheritance. And we're living in a moment when people are contending for lesser things. They'd rather have a piece of the land than to have him. But David said, when I settle the fact that the God who's eternal has become my master, then I recognize he is my portion. When he's my portion, I'm never deficient. I'm going to try that over here. I ain't get no help over there. When he's my portion, I'm never deficient. Because when he's my portion, I'm well supplied. See, I grew up in church where people spent their entire lives seeking certain things from God without ever seeking him. We sought healing. We never sought the healer. We sought deliverance. We didn't necessarily seek the deliverer. And so therefore, when healing came, it was easy for people to walk away from the one who brought it. Because we settled for something less than. He said, you're my portion, you're my cup. I'm not going to go into that. It literally means you contain, you hold everything that's mine in place. You maintain my lot. You remember when they cast lots? That's when they would put stones in a bag and roll them out. And it would be the choosing of what would be given to somebody. Basically, God saying this, I don't want to offend anybody, but if you have ever been to Vegas, God just says, when I'm the one throwing the dice, it always comes up sevens. Don't confuse that with you always get what you want. We sing a song that says something to these words. He never, never, never lets me down. I'm singing that one morning, standing in church with thousands of people. And I'm looking at the screen and I'm going, he never, never lets me down. And I'm going, that ain't true. I'm mad right now. I'm mad right now because I asked him to do something and he didn't do it. And I'm facing hell because of it. So how many of you know the words of that song have to be put in context? Because when I have purpose to do it my way, he has often let me down. When he's never, never, never let me down is when I let him maintain my lot. He threw my dice. And so when that happens, then all I can do is stand up and say, my lines have fallen to me in pleasant places. So I don't have to strive to be somebody because I am somebody.
Come on.
When I pulled in here tonight, I saw on a three-state tour in this few days that I'm out. I'm thinking 2 weeks ago, I'm standing in the second largest city in America with people everywhere in Los Angeles. You got the whole Hollywood, East LA crowd, and I'm at Dana Point and Laguna Beach. And tonight I'm in Laurinburg. And yesterday I was in Balabatri, Louisiana. I'm in Balabatri, Alabama, with Bubba Gump. That should be like a T-shirt. What do these cities have in common? Balabatri, Los Angeles, Laurinburg. But here's my point. My point is, and I feel like somebody just needs to hear this tonight. You know, it's easy for us to look out and say, I need to be that, or I need to be that, or I need to be there, or I wished I had that. When really your life is not consist of what's out there, your life is always going to consist about what's in here. You live your life from the inside out, not from the outside in. So I came to tell somebody tonight, your lines are falling to you in pleasant places, you need to learn to relax. Amen. That's a good word, Bishop. Amen. You need to learn to relax. Because here's what the Message Bible says about what Jesus said. Jesus said, if you are weary and heavy laden, I want you to come to me and find what?
Rest.
Take my yoke and learn of me. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Not many Christians I've met in America in 2020 have I believed that their yoke was easy and their burden was light. The Message Bible says it this way: come to me and learn the unforced rhythms of grace. Come to me and learn how to live your life in an unforced way, because you've learned to take my yoke upon you. You know, he was talking to religious leaders. You realize that? He was teaching the Beatitudes, but he was actually teaching a whole group of religious people that was listening, and he was comparing himself to the religious crowd. And he was saying, those guys will take you to Bible school, and when they get done, they're going to yoke you up in bondage. And you're going to be jumping through hoops, and you're going to be performing, and you're going to be crossing your T's, and you're going to be dotting your I's, and you're going to make sure you got on the right clothes, and you sing the right songs, and you have the right time limits on your church service, and you're going to be doing, and they had 692 different one of those rules you had to keep. And Jesus said, you can either compare me with that. That is heavy and burdensome and forced. Or you can come to me and realize that everything in your life flows out of relationship. Yeah. And you realize I take better care of you than you can take care of you. So if you'll just let the God of the universe become your personal God and decide what happens in your life, you can live in the unforced rhythms of grace. Amen. Praise the Lord. I'm honored to be here tonight. Lee and Heather, thank you so much. Your hospitality today has been amazing. And you guys are an incredible couple. I'm so proud of you and what you're doing in this city. Lee has been a part of a program I have called Timothy Teams. And several guys in the room have been. That's where I spend one day a month with a group of senior leaders across America and Canada. They spend a day with me and mentoring and learning, talking together. Three times a year, I bring them to Oklahoma City, or we meet somewhere in America for 2.5 days to talk and grow and expand ourselves. And Lee, how many years have you been a part of that? Five years. So I don't know if I'm a slow teacher or he's a slow learner, but anyway, he's been there 5 years. And I'm just kidding. But we're grateful for them. And but it was like almost a year ago. He said, I'm going to get so far out in Bishop's calendar, he can't tell me. He's already got it booked. And so we did. And I'm here. I told you I'd come. I'm here. And I'm glad I'm here. Come on, would you honor the angels of this house? Let's give honor tonight. Come on. Pastor Dean and Heather Jackson, we love you. We love you. If I start saying hello to everybody, I'll run out of time because I got friends everywhere. I just want y'all to know I love you and I appreciate you so very, very much. There is one person I am going to say hey to, because she spent so many years of her life keeping me in order. My personal assistant for many, many years is here tonight. Angie, I'm so glad you guys are here. Thank you for coming, being a part of being in this house. We love you. Thank you for being here tonight. I was on the plane today, and the Holy Spirit began to talk to me about tonight. What I'm going to talk about is not, let me say this accurately, it is not normal for our streams, the circles we run in. Okay? So I already know I'm going way out in left field before I get started. But I feel we're supposed to go there. I don't know how many of you in a local church or in this house grew up in what we would traditionally call a liturgical church. A church that had liturgy of some sort. You know, most Pentecostals make fun of that. They say, well, those people just read stuff off of a page and they have predictable services. And I thought, well, I've showed up at your Pentecostal church and it's just as predictable.
Amen.
You sing too fast, one slow, take an offering, preach a sermon, and go home.
Amen. Come on, Bishop.
I ain't got no help in here, but I'm going to preach. Everybody has their liturgy, whatever it is, how you function. But I was sharing with my team this week, and maybe it's just been so in me because I sense this so strongly, prophetically, for our nation and for our world right now. And I was talking to our staff, my executive team, and then I was talking to our whole pastoral team this week about how historically for 1,500 plus years, that's a long time. And there's something that's very important tonight that we teach a generation that's existing right now in the church world, that we're tied to something that's been around longer than we have. Contrary to popular belief, worship didn't begin with Hillsong. Creativity didn't begin with Steve Furtick. We tend to say, well, that's old, and we go back to the 80s. I'm at a conference in England a couple of years ago. It's the largest conference held in the UK. And I'm standing in front of about 15 or 17,000 people getting ready to preach. And they sing this song that is an incredible song. I mean, the place is coming unglued. People are dancing and shouting. And you sense the anointing of the Holy Ghost there. And I turned to my host, who has invited me, and I said to him, and the basic, I need to change mics. Did I wear that one out already?
Oh, yeah.
Basically, I said to Stuart, I said, I love this song. And they were basically singing, "The cross has won the field." And I said, "Is this a new song? Martin Smith was there," and I said, "Did he write it? Did one of these guys write this?" And he said, "Oh, no. He said, "That song was written in 812. Not 812 yesterday morning. It's an old Celtic song that the Celtic Christians sang when the gospel first came to the British Isles. And 1,200 years later, we were singing it and rejoicing and celebrating. And you begin to realize that we're part of something that is bigger than us. And it's not going to fall apart based on a 100-year pandemic or a 4-year election. This thing has deeper roots. It has survived the Dark Ages, the Crusades. It survived the Roman Empire. It survived world wars. It survived communism, fascism. It survived dictators. It survived all kinds of people that lived in jungles that have never heard the name of Jesus. Guess what? It is still going to be here in 2021. Amen. It's still going to be here. But historically, the church has followed a basic calendar throughout the year in order to disciple people and to bring people into a fullness of Christ. And I think we're in a season right now where the only thing the pandemic did, you know what? The pandemic did not make churches weak and didn't make Christians weak. It revealed weakness. It revealed what was in us. It revealed that some of the stuff we had been propagating couldn't really take people through the stuff that they were facing. And we became content to have shallow, experiential, attractional meetings rather than to really get people discipled and becoming true followers of Christ. Because how many of you recognize to be a follower of Christ is not a one-time decision? Because every time your life comes to a crossroads and you get a choice to go in a different direction, you get to choose whether or not you're going to follow. There's a lot of people that followed him to an altar to get born again. They just don't follow him to a place of getting sanctified. Because they won't give him their language, their habits, their mind. There's a lot of people that followed him to an altar to get saved. They just didn't follow him to the altar with their marriage. To follow him into how to be a husband that represents who Christ is to the church, or a wife that learns how to represent what it means to receive that. So in order to disciple people, historically what the church world did is they preached through a biblical calendar every year. And what it did, and for all of the preachers in the room, and all of us are guilty, see, what happens is if I don't intentionalize, and I've done this for years as a pastor of a local church, I intentionalize every year I sit down with my team and talk about what 12 main or 10 or 12 main things do we feel like our church needs to hear this year. And then we build our calendar around it. Because if I don't do that, here's what's going to happen. I'm going to preach my hobby horse. I'm going to talk to Stephen. I'll just preach my hobby horse. Whatever it is that turns my motor, I'll preach about it in 52 different ways. And if I like praise, I'll preach about praise from one side. I'll preach it from another side. I'll preach it from another side. I'll find somewhere to preach about it because that's my hobby horse. But that's laziness as a spiritual leader who's trying to disciple people. So we end up with lopsided Christians. Who are really strong on their right side. They just don't have anything on their left side. So when the wind blows from the other direction, they get blown over. Because how many of you know that we call ourselves full gospel churches? We just sometimes don't preach the full gospel. And so what it forces us to do, historically, the church did through what they call a liturgical calendar. And it began in this season we're in right now. In fact, for all the people that have any following of it whatsoever, it began last Sunday. November 29th began what's called Advent. And Advent led to Christmas time, or to Christmas, and then after Christmas was Christmas time. You know, the 12 days of Christmas are not the 12 days leading up to Christmas. The 12 days of Christmas are the 12 days after Christmas. And that song was written to people to be, it was a hidden message of the power of the cross. You can Google this and find it. Every one of those things represents something that Jesus came to people to bring. Because on the 12th day is what's called the Epiphany. And the Epiphany was when, over a process of a couple of years, the wise men showed up on what would have been Epiphany, which for us this year is January 6th, 12 days after Christmas. Move forward 30 years, Jesus was baptized on Epiphany. Because see, the word Advent means coming. It's an expected arrival. Something is coming. It comes from the Latin word Adventus, which means a coming or an arrival, but it really comes from the Greek word parousia, which for all of the people that have ever taught about the second coming, that's the word that's in the Bible used for the coming of the Lord. But it's also the word that was indicated for the Advent season. And they would go from Advent to Christmas time to Lent, where we would learn that our appetites don't control us, but the Spirit does. And then we'd end up at the cross for Passover, And we'd end up with a resurrection. Coming out of the resurrection, we'd recognize that we have 50 days to begin to prepare our hearts and move ourselves into the life of the Spirit and the outpouring of Pentecost, when God would write his laws no longer on stony tablets, but he'd write them on the hearts of men. And then coming out of Pentecost, we'd have a great thrust, because we'd be preparing for tabernacles when Jesus would come and tabernacle among us, and we'd recognize the manifesting presence of God living among his people. So every year they would take the people of God through that calendar, where we would talk about an expectation that gives birth to a promise, that gives a yuletide understanding of how that promise fulfills itself in your life. And then that demands that you come to a place of submission with your appetites and your desires and your hungers, till you can then give birth to a resurrected Christ that will move into your life with power. And out of the power of a resurrected Christ on Pentecost, you can then live as a tabernacle Christian. Because really what God doesn't want to do, he doesn't want to live in a church building on Sunday morning. He wants to live in you while you're at work. He wants to tabernacle among people. You say, Bishop, I'm lost. Let me tell you what happened. I'm sitting on the plane today, and I could not get this passage out of my spirit. It's in Isaiah chapter 9, verse number 2. And it says, the people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. And those who dwelt in the land of the shadow of death, upon them a light has shined. Do you know what that says? That says the world. Let me tell you the condition. He said the world was sitting and walking in darkness, but they saw a great light. I want to speak to every person in this room. Listen to me closely. You cannot be confused by the chaos. Because if you get confused by the chaos, you'll miss the creative moments. Because to the people who sit in darkness, God shines a great light. And those who dwell in the shadow of death, listen, in other words, every place that death is operative. And in this room tonight, you need to understand something. There are people in here that you are spiritually alive, and if you die, you're going to go to heaven, but death is operative in parts of your life. You're alive, but not fully alive.
Amen.
For some in this room, it's their emotions are dead. They'd say things like this, I haven't felt anything in months. Some are creatively dead. There are some people who are financially, death is working in your finances. You are in the shadow of death in your resources. My point about that is, he says every place that darkness exists and every place that death is breaking out, I'm going to let light shine. I'm going to let light shine. And then he goes on to say this. He said, I'm going to see how that light can get here. He said, so you have multiplied the nation and increased its joy. They rejoice before you according to the joy of harvest, as men rejoice when they divide spoils. For you, capital Y, you, Jesus, have broken the yoke of his burden and the staff of his shoulder and the rod of his oppressor in the days of Midian. And for every warrior's sandal from a noisy battle and garments rolled in blood, we will use for burning and fuel of fire. For unto us a child is born, and unto us a son is given. I could spend the next two nights talking about that, because there's a difference between a child and a son. Children are born. Sons are given. The child was very natural. The son was very supernatural. Lots of children had been born, but there had not been sons who could break the yoke of bondage.
Come on.
And the Bible declares that For unto us a child is born, and a son has been given, and the government will be on his shoulders. Man, I'm going to leave that alone, but I'll just say this. There's nobody in Washington, D.C. that's big enough to carry the government on their shoulders. The government will be upon his shoulders, and his name will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. And of the increase of his government and peace, there will be no end. And upon the throne of David and over his kingdom, to order it and to establish it with judgment and justice from this time forward forevermore. For the zeal of the Lord of hosts will perform this. Now listen to me closely. I'm gonna hurry and get through this. God says that every place that darkness is operative, I believe that darkness is operating in North Carolina. I believe it's operating in Oklahoma. I believe darkness is operating in America. There's never been a time in history that we had bigger churches in America than we have tonight. And there's never been a time we have less influence. So obviously it's not our crowds that are changing the world. Because what happened with Isaiah? Isaiah, 700 years before the birth of Jesus, do you know what he's doing? He's positioning the people who are in a place of disillusionment, discouragement, dysfunction, people that are being pressed on by darkness and being overcome by empires. Here's what he's telling them. I want you to get up on your tippy toes with expectation, because something is coming that's about to roll away your darkness. It's about to break the yoke of iron off of your life, and it's about to free you into places you never thought you could be freed before. But here's your posture. Your posture is not, oh my, God's forgotten us. Where did God go? This is the worst year of my life. He said, no, if you really want to experience the child that was born and the son that's been given, you got to get up on your tippy toes and start looking and declaring, there's something coming. There's something on the way. I have an expectation that God is about to do something I cannot explain. I don't know how, I don't know when, but I know it's coming. And the Holy Spirit said to me, he said, if the church does not build an expectation in this moment of darkness, they'll miss the moment. This is not a time. I might as well preach, I'm here. This is not a time for us to sell out our expectation to just have a seat at the party table.
Yes.
I'm looking for something more than a president. I'm not on my tippy toes looking for a Republican or a Democrat. I'm on my tippy toes looking for one whose eyes are like a flame of fire, whose hair is white like wool, and out of his mouth goes a two-edged sword, and he holds the keys of hell and death. Have I got anybody in the room that's got that kind of expectation? That, my friends, is what Advent's all about.
Come on. Come on. Come on.
It's about us expecting him to come. The Bible gives reference to three specific comings of the Lord. In fact, in the New Testament, I'm not going to mess with you theologically, but even just after the cross, there was at least five different comings and goings of Jesus after the resurrection. Selah. Somebody said, is he coming back? He's already came like five times.
Come on.
Mary Magdalene met him right outside the tomb. And he said to her, don't cling to me. I've not yet ascended to my Father. Somebody talk to me. He said, I've not yet ascended to my Father. So don't cling to me. Don't hold me here. And then he shows up a chapter later and looks at Thomas and said, go ahead and touch me. Obviously, he descended. Obviously, he descended and come back. He completed the mercy seat and returned to help an unbelieving disciple get into a place of faith. And then he had another whole group that was locked up in a room, and they didn't know where he was. He left again, and there was nowhere to be found. All of a sudden, he appeared walking through doors and came in the room. Says, boys, what are y'all hiding from? Why? Because watch this. He first comes to a manger, and at the end of the age, he comes in glory. But in between the manger and glory, he comes multiple times to people who are in expectation, who are sitting in darkness, who are living in the places where death is breaking out. He continues to come to them. And watch this. He doesn't come for me. He comes to me. Maybe God's not going to take you out of it. Maybe he's going to empower you to go through it. Maybe he's coming to you. And maybe we're to be on our tippy toes, going, we're in another season of great darkness. And death is breaking out everywhere. I heard Dr. Fauci this past week gave a report that somewhere between 30 and 60 million school-aged children are fighting depression because they've been locked up at home. In my city, a 42% increase in divorces in 8 months. 36% rise in suicide. Death is working everywhere. And the people who are supposed to be the people of God, who crave prophetic things, we treat prophecy like it's a fortune teller. Tell me who's going to win, who's going to lose. When really the prophetic word ought to get you up off your seat and onto your toes.
Yes.
Going, it really doesn't matter to me who wins. I know who's coming. And the one that's coming for me is greater than anybody who can win. Because unto me a child is going to be born. And unto me a son is going to be given. And the government of my life is going to be upon his shoulders. And of the increase of that government and peace, there shall be no end. Can I tell you what? Listen. The difference between a relationship with Jesus and religion, one of the places you can know whether or not you're being religious or really walking in a relationship, is religion always tries to have an answer for every question. If you were to pass out a piece of paper to religious folks and put blanks in them, they would be miserable if they didn't get every one of them filled. Because somehow we think because we got a leather-bound Bible, we ought to know everything. And even if we don't know, we make it up. I'm getting ready. I'll be 43 years I've been leading the local church. And I can't tell you the times I've looked across at a couple burying their 12-year-old with cancer. Or looked across at a wife like I did this spring whose husband couldn't take another day of being quarantined and locked up. And with three kids, took his own life, left three girls, 9, 6, and 4 years old. You cannot tie your faith to what he can do. You have to tie your faith to who he is. Because God's very intentional. Would we be in agreement? How many of you know if he does something, he does it intentionally?
Amen.
I got a pretty good amen right there. How many of you believe if God does something, he does it intentionally?
Amen.
Amen. And most of us, when he does something intentionally, we rejoice. But here's the other side of that. If he doesn't do something, he doesn't do it intentionally. Even though I don't understand why he didn't do it, I can trust him because he's always faithful.
Amen.
See, Mary and Martha tied their faith to what he could do, but had never met who he was. So when they called and said, Lazarus is sick, I mean, you know, they called because they expected him to come. And the Bible says he stayed where he was 2 days more. And then it took him 2 days to get there. Now, I know in North Carolina that you guys probably, that wouldn't bother you a bit. But I know a lot of places that if you called the pastor and said, Mama's up here in the hospital dying, and he just said, okay, I'll be there in a couple days, you wouldn't want him to be your pastor anymore.
That's right.
But that's really what Jesus did to Mary and Martha. Because when he showed up, they were ticked. In fact, so mad, only one of them came out of the house. And when they came out, they said to him, if you'd have been here, if you'd have been the God I thought you were, you'd have done something about this. See, this is what our nation is today. I pastor a church that's 50-60% people of color. I pastor a church where 15-20% of our people are Hispanic. Some of the leadership in our church are tied strongly to the Hispanic community. I had in my house a man who 15 years ago came into America. And overstayed his visa illegally, met an American girl, got married, they have 4 kids. He's been working a job paying taxes. But all of a sudden, ICE found him. And deported him. And as a pastor, I'm trying to look into the eyes of teenagers and explain what this is all about. When I take my African-American leaders to a restaurant and look across the table from 20 of my major businessmen, businesswomen, influencers in our city, people that have major positions at universities, work for national agencies. They're catching all kind of flack in their neighborhood because they got a white pastor and nobody seems to care. And all some people want to offer them is what they should have done, what the police told them. And don't even want to acknowledge the fact that certain injustices are a part of our world. That's where Mary and Martha were. That's where they were. I put my confidence in you, Jesus, and when I needed you, you didn't show. Because I built my faith in what you could do. But what I didn't realize is that when I build my faith only in what you can do, I relegate myself to a seat where death will always be operative. Because if you live long enough, ladies and gentlemen, I can guarantee you there's some things going to happen in your life that you did not want to happen. Because every time you get what you want, you get a whole lot of what you don't want. No, I ain't got no help. Every time you get like a supernatural blessing, you get stuck with that blessing you didn't want. See, there's a lot of people said, you know, I'd love to have a $200,000 a year job. Well, when you get to $200,000 a year job, you also get higher tax brackets. You also get greater responsibility. You get other things you have to deal with. Well, I wanted to be the manager. Okay, then you don't get days off. You get to work every day. I had a guy tell me one time, he said, I want to own my own business so I can come and go as I please. I said, don't do that. Work for somebody else. Because if you own it, if nobody shows up, you are the business. Because when you get what you want, you also get a whole lot of stuff you don't want. And Mary and Martha were ticked because they had tied themselves to Jesus. We are now sitting in a place where death is operative. Right here, right what Isaiah had said 700 years earlier. He said there's going to be people that are going to be sitting in a place where death is operating. And they looked at Jesus and said, if you'd have been here, you wouldn't have died. You didn't live up to your part. And here's what I love about Jesus. Jesus didn't correct them. He didn't say to Mary and Martha, you should go to a praise meeting. You need to get your attitude changed. This is where we're missing in our nation. This is what has to happen in America, in the church world. Jesus already knew what he was going to do. He knew what he was going to do with Lazarus. It was to the glory of God. He knew that. He knew that Lazarus was not really dead for eternal purposes. But watch what he does. When Mary and Martha, a man, ticked, Jesus' response was this. It's the shortest verse in the Bible. It said, Jesus wept. He entered into their pain, even though he knew he was going to fix it. Maybe the world doesn't want to hear what the church has got to say right now because all we've been doing is pontificating, spouting out what everybody should be doing when really we should be entering into their pain and saying, I know death is operative right here in your life, but what you need is a great light to shine into you. Jesus wept with them. And then he said to them, take me to where you laid him. In other words, watch this, I'm almost done. Take me to the place where you quit believing. Take me to the place where you came down off your tippy toes and you didn't expect anything to be different. Because where you quit expecting it to be different, you lock death up. And I've come to show you how to be fully alive. Do you know why he says a child was born and a son was given? It's because Jesus was 100% God. Jesus didn't start existing at Christmas. John 1:1 says, in the beginning was the Word. In other words, the actual Greek language there says, before the beginning began was the Word. And the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Jesus has existed eternally. But the eternal God took on flesh. That's what John 1 says. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. And we beheld him as the only begotten Son of God, full of grace and truth. Watch this. And when Jesus came, he was fully 100% God. But don't miss this. Not only was a son given, but a child was born. Because he was 100% fully man. We forget that. We believe that everything Jesus did in this Bible, he did as the Son of God. That's not true. Everything Jesus did in the miracles of the Gospels, he didn't do them as God. He did them as the Son of Man. Because had he done them as God, he wouldn't be able to look at you and I and say, the works I've done, you can do.
Come on, glory to God.
Because I'm not deity. He said, I'm a man just like you are.
That's right.
I'm fully human just like you are. I feel, I touch, I've liked, I've been hungry, I've been hurt, I've been betrayed, I've been disappointed, I've been happy, I've partied, I've celebrated, I've laughed. I've walked down the road with my friends and told stories and laughed out loud. But see, most of us want to tap into the God who's fully God, and we want to live in this realm where everything is just totally, completely this God realm. When actually Jesus came to show us how to be fully alive as people. To live fully alive as people. And he said, in order for that to happen, watch this. He said, a light has to shine into your darkness. Don't miss what I'm about to say. Everybody in this room lives to the light you have. And if you're ever going to go to another level, you've got to have greater light. In the beginning, when God spoke into the chaos, see, this is why you can't be confused by the chaos, because in Genesis 1, the chaos was a creative moment. Ain't got no help. In Genesis 1, the chaos was a creative moment. In Exodus 12, when the Exodus took place, it was chaotic, but God was bringing forth a deliverer. In Matthew chapter 2:1-2, in Luke chapter 2, when Jesus was born, the earth was in chaos. The Roman Empire was upside down. Babies were being killed. Male children below the age of 2 were being killed. It was chaotic, but a creative moment was about to be birthed. In Acts chapter 2, when thousands of people were in the street and heard folks speaking in tongues, it became chaos. In fact, the Bible says they were perplexed and full of chaos. Why? Because God was about to create a kingdom of which there shall be no end. So in every chaotic, dark moment, there is a light that's about to shine, that's going to give birth to something that is creative, that's going to accelerate the purposes of God in the earth. And if you get confused by the chaos, you miss the creative moment. So into the chaos, what does God say in Genesis chapter 1? In Genesis chapter 1, into the chaos, God said, let there be. And there was
light.
I mean, we know that wasn't sunlight. The sun wasn't created till the fourth day. What was he saying? I'm going to illuminate the environment with my wisdom so that I can begin to make order out of chaos. And I'll begin to develop strategies that bring victories. And everything that's out of place will get back in its place. But watch this. Do you notice? He never had to say, let there be darkness. Because light is the only thing that can be measured. You can't measure darkness. I'm going to wait on you. You're worth waiting on. Come on, somebody. That's why you can walk in measures of light, but you don't walk in measures of darkness. I mean, you know, I can go to Home Depot and I can get a 50-watt bulb, or I can get a 100-watt bulb, or I can get a 500-watt bulb, or I can get a 1,000-watt bulb. How many of you know a soft, white, 50-amp bulb will illuminate the lighted room a little bit, but how many of you know a laser beam will cut through steel? It's all the same stuff. Maybe some of the tangled up mess in your life you can't cut through because you hadn't got enough light yet. Maybe what the darkness is waiting for is the light to show up. Maybe the reason death is operative is because light hadn't come. You live at the level of your light. And if you never ask for more light, you never get to move to greater places in your life. Do you remember a guy named Paul? Paul was on his way, the Bible says he was on his way to Damascus with letters of authority from the chief priest. That means he had the government and the church's permission to be killing Christians. You missed that. He had the government and the church's permission to be killing Christians. But notice what he says. I was on my way to Damascus with letters from the chief priest when suddenly a bright light. In other words, suddenly I had a light hit my life that was brighter than the light that was in my life. Because as a good Jew, I was living up to the light I had. I was doing what I was supposed to be doing. See, that's why you can't just be a good assembly of God, or just a good PH, or just a good church of God, or just a good Baptist. Because if you only live to the light of a Baptist or an assembly of God or church of God, then that's all you'll ever be. And you might be killing something you ought to be keeping alive. But when you're on your way and God decides to let a brighter light shine into your life, all of a sudden you'll realize what I was on my way to do is not what I was born to do. And instead of killing Christians, he became one. I came to talk to somebody tonight. God is about to shine in Laurinburg, North Carolina. He's about to shine in Rockingham. He's about to shine where you live. A brighter light is about to appear, and it's going to break out the darkness from around you, and it's going to release life. Come on, everybody, get on your feet. Throw your hands in the air. The light of God. Come on.
Shine a light, yeah. Shine a light, and let the whole world see. We cry out for the glory of the risen King. We sing, God, shine a light, and let the whole world see.
Because you keep fighting in darkness. There is an illumination that comes by the Holy Ghost. You really don't have faith until you have illumination. So here's what he said. He said, when this light shines, his name will be called Wonderful Counselor. In other words, his wisdom will be able to counsel your life. I know people that got saved and never asked God at all to change their mind. They just added church to their life. And they still think like they did before they got saved. Now, they don't think like they did about Sundays. Because Sundays used to be at the lake. Now Sunday's at church. But I'm talking about when it comes to how do they deal with their isolation, their loneliness, their relationships, their destiny. And the reason I know the light has not come from his counsel is because they still say things like this. Well, ain't nobody from our neighborhood ever done that. Well, I'll tell you what, somebody else, but ain't nobody ever from Laurinburg done that. How do you know that? Because I have a son-in-law that was born and raised right here. And I know the days he fell across my lap weeping when he'd go, how did I think that way? I said, you walk in the light you have until a brighter light shines.
That's right, that's right.
You don't get under condemnation. You just say, become my wise counselor. My counsel is not the news media or the neighborhood I came from or the family I'm out of. Whoever is informing you is forming you. If I could spend 30 minutes with you, I can tell you who you've been listening to, and I guarantee you, if you show me your life, it's reflective of who you've been listening to. That's why if you keep hanging out with Bubba and Boo Boo, and Bubba and Boo Boo are dumb as a bag of rocks, guess what? It ain't gonna be long. Your life reflects that. Because whoever keeps informing you is forming you. So he said, here's what's going to happen. When this Messiah shows up, he's not going to take away all the pain in the earth. He's going to show you the wisdom of how to get out of the pain that's in the earth. He's going to counsel you on how to make things work that you didn't think could work. He's going to be called Mighty God. Anybody in the room tonight need a Mighty God? Yeah, Mighty. See, God does his best work in the dark. Elijah was in a cave at night, the Bible says, when the voice of the Lord said, there's a still small voice about to speak to you. Go stand in the face of the cave. The children of Israel were brought out of Egypt at nighttime with a mighty hand. With a mighty hand. That's why you can't be afraid of the dark. Jesus laid in the tomb and the earth thought, he's gone. Death is operative. He's gone forever. And the cold, still tomb was dark for 3 days. What they didn't realize is that he wasn't really in that tomb. In those 3 days, he had gone into the bowels of the earth, and he had conquered and led victorious those who for generations had been standing on their tippy toes waiting for him to come. Isaiah said, I died before he got here. Daniel said, I died before he got here. David said, I died before he got here. But I died looking because I knew he was coming. And one day he walked through the gates of hell and said, the one you've been looking for is here. And I got the keys of hell and death. And out of the darkness he brought them forth. And on the first day of the week, early in the morning, up from the grave, he arose. God does his best work in the dark. Mighty God. Let me tell you how God responds to mighty people. Here's what causes the mighty God to work is when you and I say, I'm not mighty. I went into my prayer closet recently, and the Holy Spirit was dealing with me about something in my life. And I started to repent. Because my life has been one of a lot of confrontations, a lot of battles, a lot of things to do the stuff we've done. And the Holy Spirit said to me, he said, you despise weakness. When you see weakness in people, you're not attracted to them. Because you have a great affinity for strength. He said, but what you don't understand, as long as you're strong, I can't be. It's when you're weak, my strength becomes perfect. And I said, God, forgive me. I need a mighty God. I don't need a well-developed Tony God. I don't need a God that's a preacher God. I need a mighty God. So I'm not going to despise weakness, and I'm not going to despise vulnerability, and I'm not going to despise the times I've had to say, I need help. I need somebody to help me get up because I don't know how to get up on my own. Because when you acknowledge I don't have it all together and I'm not really that strong, see, it's your pride that wants you to make everybody think you're strong and I got the world by the tail and I can do this all on my own. He said, but when you humble yourself and say, I don't know how to get up, and I don't know how to come in, and I don't know how to go out, but you're a mighty God, I believe you can break this addiction. You can set this captive free. You can open this prison door because you are a mighty God. He's wise enough to counsel us. He's mighty enough to deliver us. Everlasting Father, he's tender enough to develop us. And he's the Prince of Peace. He's peaceful enough that we don't have to strive. The shalom of God can settle over your life. I don't know who I'm talking to. God interrupted what I planned on preaching tonight because he said there's going to be a group of people in Laurinburg on the plane flying up here from Atlanta. He said there's going to be a group of people who are sitting in darkness and they don't know what to do with the darkness. And they're in a place where death seems to be operative. Things around them look like they're not going well and they're not going to work out the way they wanted them to work out. But I'm going to let a bright light shine to everybody whose heart is open, and I will give them the counsel of the Lord, and I will give them the might of my strength, and I will give them the Father's heart that I have for them, and I'll release my peace over their life. I don't know where you are, but Stephen's going to start to worship, and I want a push to come out of you. We're not finished, so don't leave. But if that's you, if you say, Bishop, that's me, I am sitting in that place. I am ready tonight for a bright light to shine into my life. Get out of where you are and come meet me right here in the name of Jesus. Come on, come on, come on.
My God, how great you are.
Come on. Gary, I hear the Holy Ghost saying this. He is the fixer of all things. I don't know what this means, but I see you sitting in a chair in a room, and you're asking yourself, I don't know what to do with all this. I don't know what to do with all this. And up until now, every time you knew what to do, but this time you said, I don't know what to do. And I hear the Holy Ghost saying, I know everything. And there's two things the Holy Spirit says to me, and I don't know, you pray them through. I hear the Holy Spirit saying, I'm going to reveal the things that are in darkness that acts like it's in light. There are some people around you that have acted like they've been operating in light, and they've actually been operating in darkness. They are angels of light. But here's the news for you. Second thing is this. God says, I'm coming to you. I'm going to come to you. He's coming to you with wisdom, and he's coming to you with power. And this is a strong word. The Holy Spirit says, and righteousness and justice will be the scales that set in the room with you. And God says, I make righteous judgments. Righteous judgments. I don't know, but I see a judge ruling in your favor. There's a righteous judgment that is about to be released on your bed. And I declare that in the name of the Lord. I hear the Holy Ghost say, and he's about to change your mind. He's bigger than you think he is. Holy Ghost, come on, somebody help me pray. There's a power, there's an anointing here right now. Come here, Jonathan, lay your hands on him. Gary, I don't know what you do, but I hear the Lord saying, the latter will be greater than the former. The latter will be greater than the former. Ooh, Rasatai, Brusatai. Come on, somebody shout, breathe, 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 breathe. You feel like the life has been sucked out of you, but I hear the Holy Ghost saying, breathe, 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 breathe. Hey, Rasata, Rabataka, Brusato, Kubrando, Rabasata. Brandi Lamashata. Can you come right here? Stand right here. Stand right here. I hear the Holy Spirit saying this. There were times like Humpty Dumpty had a great fall, and all the king's horses and all the king's men couldn't put Humpty Dumpty back together again. But I hear the Holy Spirit saying, I'm not Humpty Dumpty. And there are things that you have been willing to put up on the shelf and say, okay, I'll let it go. I'm ready. I don't care. We hear the Lord say, it's time for you to get your dream back. It's time for you to get your dream back. The thing that used to wake you up every morning, the thing that used to burn on the inside of you when you'd pray, you'd sense certain things, and it became fragmented. I hear the Lord saying, I'm about to put the dream back together again. By the power of the Holy Ghost. And I declare over you, there'll be nothing lost. Nothing lost. In the name of Jesus. Come on, somebody help me pray. Don't stop praying. Help me pray. There's a corporate anointing in here right now. The Holy Ghost. Live, live, fully alive, fully alive. In the name of Jesus. His word becomes a light unto your pathway and a lamp unto your feet. I hear the Lord saying, I'm going to make the path plain. It's going to be clear. I'm going to declare over you, this is a future word, I'm going to declare over you, the day will come when out of you will flow rivers of living water.
Yes, sir.
That people did not even imagine.
Yes, sir.
When you open your mouth, there'll flow rivers. I declare rivers, rivers, rivers of living water that comes out of you. And this is a strong word. That water will come from a place called Gilead. It's going to be bubbling up springs that are healing. Hallelujah. I release a healing anointing on you now in the name of Jesus. It's going to be supernatural. It's going to be for your generation in supernatural ways like never before. Chris Diller, come help me. Just lay your hands on this man. Out of his innermost being, rivers. You will not be confused about what it's about. Rivers. Rivers. Somebody help me. Somebody just shout rivers. Rivers, rivers, rivers. Come on, lift up holy hands. Father, tonight we pray. We agree in the name of Jesus. We agree that light shining tonight. We agree that supernatural light has come. We believe that you're shining into our lives tonight. Things that we never thought were possible. We believe tonight that strongholds are being broken. We believe tonight that every place death is operative. Father, I thank you tonight for counsel. I don't know who in the building needs this, but I hear the Lord saying, supernatural counsel is coming to you. Supernatural counsel is coming to you. You don't know what to do, but supernatural counsel is coming to you. Do you guys go together? Hold hands. I hear the Holy Spirit saying, you pray this through. Haggai chapter 1. He said to the people, you've sown much, you've reaped little. You've drank, but you're not satisfied. You've ate, but you're not full. And the word of the Lord came to him and said, get to the mountain and get wood, because I'm about to build something in you again. And it said, and the Spirit of the Lord stirred up the hearts of the people and the hearts of Zerubbabel. I'm prophesying to you, the Spirit of God's about to stir you in ways like you haven't been stirred. It's because there's something else to be built. There's another season. You're not finished. There's another season of building that is about to take place. And when you get it built, you're going to look back like Haggai 2 and say the glory of the latter is going to be greater than the glory of the former. Because God says, I'm going to outdo myself. I don't know what you experienced before, but the Holy Ghost says, I'm going to outdo myself. Because only God can outdo God. Only God can outdo God. But he's about to outdo himself in your life. And I declare the bags that have holes in them will stop. There's no longer going to be a drain. There's not going to be diminishing return. There is going to be a sufficient return. Boom, I seal it up in the name of Jesus. And I declare that the building of the Lord shall now begin to take place. Ta, rosa, pronde, bratatata, sukotora basata. And the glory of the latter will be greater. Greater than the glory of the former. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Jesus' name. You guys go together, right? Yeah. Hold hands. Deuteronomy chapter 1. I hear the Lord saying, you've been here long enough. You've been at this mountain long enough. Turn and begin to make your way towards what I promised you. You were not meant to be wilderness dwellers. There is a land that flows with milk and honey. I have no idea what I'm talking about. But I hear the Lord saying this. I am not going to let you live in a land that you just measle out two or three things here or there. There's not going to be a here good day and five bad days and here good day. And oh, here's a little bit of an opportunity. I hear the Lord saying, I'm about to open a door no man can close. And I'm going to let you step into a place that when you step into that place, it'll be a land that flows. it flows. Ha, Rusata. It will drink the rain of heaven. It will drink the rain of heaven. Up until now, you've had to water your fields with the irrigation foot pumps of Egypt. But I declare now, you will no longer have to water your crops by effort and by effort and by effort, for it will drink the rain of heaven. God says, I'm going to give you crops you didn't ask for. I'm going to let you live in places you didn't have to build. And you're going to drink from wells you don't have to dig. For the faithfulness of the Lord is going to be revealed unto you. And I'm declaring over you, the zeal of the Lord shall perform this. And I don't know anything about your life at all, but I hear the Holy Spirit saying this. You, ma'am, have put a lot on the back burner in order to be faithful. You said yes when a lot of people would have said no. And God said, I am not so ungrateful as to forget your labor of love. And there are things that he has dreamed about that you have followed and supported. But I hear the Lord saying, I didn't forget you. And 2021 will be about a revealing of things that God had promised you. Because he saw you weep your way through your yes. And he's now going to shower you with his grace. I don't know what this means, but I see physical buildings, and I see something to do with generational blessings that are going to flow through your life. You must know that God has not forgotten you. Don't be afraid to ask. Don't be afraid to ask. There's something about your voice that he's attracted to. If you'll just ask, speak it, sing it, declare it, just ask. I feel the Holy Ghost on that. Just ask. There's a visitation coming to your home. When the Roman centurion came to Jesus, he said to Jesus, back at the house is where my problem's at. My servant at the house is sick. And Jesus said, I'll come. And he said, no, you don't even have to come. Just speak the word. And I don't know what this means, but I hear the Lord saying, you need a house visit. And Jesus said, I make house calls. I send my word, and it delivered them. I send my word, and it healed them. I send my word, and it began to set things in order. Just lift your hands, would you? Father, I thank you that you're going to make a house call. It won't come through her. You're going to send your word. And it will deliver them. It will deliver them. Deliverance will come. In the name of Jesus. Whew. Holy Ghost. Holy Ghost. Holy Ghost. Jonathan, you have something you're supposed to share? You guys join hands, Angie. Allie? Where's Angie? Come here, mama, to be. Weeping lasts for the night, but joy comes in the morning. strong word. I just want you guys to pray it through. Fruitfulness. Joseph was a vine that grew over the walls. And I hear the Holy Spirit saying, you're coming into a season where the things you felt boundaried you, he's going to allow you to reach over them. You're going to be like a vine that grows over the wall. And there's going to be great joy that comes. Now I'm going to speak into this prophetically, but you have to pray it. Because there's a prophecy that was given to Judah that said the scepter will be in your hands and you will be in a place. Joseph, you will be a vine that grows over the wall. And in Ezekiel, God takes the stick of Judah and the stick of Ephraim, which is Joseph's tribe, and he makes them one. And I hear the Holy Ghost saying, I have taken what was meant to be a governmental authority and a translocal authority, and I've put them into one couple. And I've said to you, not only will you rule in your place, but you'll grow over your walls with influence. And joy will come. For you'll not be restricted. You will live in the abounding place. Fruitful, abounding place. But you must know, I've given you authority to rule in one place, but I've given you grace to be translocal. Your influence is bigger than where you're at. So you'll rule and you'll grow over the walls. I declare that over you in the name of the Lord. In Jesus' name. And I declare there will be a healthy delivery. And I speak to this child, the song of the Lord. The song of the Lord resides within you. And you shall sing. You shall have rhythm and dance. And the joy of the Lord shall be upon you. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. It was the day your mother told me she didn't sing and she didn't dance. But I say to you, you will sing and you will dance. The Lord. In Jesus' name. One more time, just lift up holy hands. Father, I thank you for a grace tonight that's on this house. I declare into this region of North Carolina, a bright light is shining. And greater light is coming. And out of the greater light, new understanding and new direction and new assignments will be revealed. And I thank you for that tonight. I thank you for that tonight. Come here, sir. In the blue shirt. Yeah, is that your wife? Bring her with you. Come. Just come. Brighter lights are shining. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Let me just hold your hands. I declare that your hands will not hang down and your knees will not be weary. He's coming to lift the hands that hang down and to strengthen the knees that have shook. I don't know what this means, but I hear the Lord saying, I'm giving you strength that's sufficient to your days. Strength that is sufficient to your days. You will not grow weary and stumble. For the Lord who is able to keep you from stumbling is now standing you up. And I declare, greater light. Greater light. In Jesus' name. You must get in your place. The hand of the Lord is strengthening you. for the day of battle. He's strengthening you. Whew. I don't think I've shared this with anybody in years. Job said this, I clapped my hands and I hissed the enemy away. He has trained your hands for warfare. I see you in your house clapping your hands and running the powers of darkness out of your house. You clap your hands and you drive the enemy away. We're going to start with you tonight. Come on, somebody help me. Just clap your hands here. Shout with a voice of triumph because you're driving the enemy away. Hey! Hey! Just everybody be seated just a moment if you would. Just before Pastor comes. What a joy and honor it has been for me to be here tonight. Whew. You know, I love this region. Apostle Eddie, from the days I've been at your place, incredible times. Yeah, I'll come. I'm in Oklahoma City tonight because of something happened in Laurinburg. I was preaching for Kenneth and Joyce Bleas, who are, in my mind, the statement of what kingdom statesmen are all about. They are it. They're incredible people. And in the middle, Sister Bleas was leading worship on a Sunday morning, and the presence of God so filled that room. I laid down on the floor. I was a guest speaker. I laid down on the floor. And in about 4 minutes, the Holy Spirit spoke to me and said, the heartland of America is calling your name. And this is the plan. And I got up and wrote it in my journal, and I handed it to Jay Pike. And I said, we're headed to the Midwest. And I was out of Laurinburg. Wow. I had just told them a week before, for the fifth time, I was not coming. And I came to Laurinburg. A brighter light shined. I'm going to ask you to do something tonight, if you would. Two things I want to tell you about. One is, I don't carry a lot of product stuff with me anymore because we just created our digital library, which has been released, and about 400 hours of teaching that's on there. There's three things that'll be on this library forever. As long as we can keep putting stuff on it. There's sermon material. There's leadership teaching material. And there are interviews that are being added to this weekly that I had with some of the greatest statesmen. Some of them have gone to be with Jesus. One of them is Jonathan's dad, Dr. Kelly Varner. He and I used to do a thing called 2 Men in a Bible. People would come from all over America. We'd sit for 4 hours on chairs like this and just talk about Revelation. And we captured some of that stuff, and it's going to be on this digital library. It's going to be available, some of the greatest material and stuff that I think ever existed. And some of it's video, some of it is audio, but it goes all the way back. We found stuff back into the 90s, and I've got some stuff. We just got to get it from cassette to where it can be digitized. Stuff that I haven't preached since the late 80s. That literally became material that built my life. And it's on this library. So that means rather than buying one sermon series for $15 or $20, you can get the library every month for $9. $9.99. Yeah, I gotta ask Cole what it is. I don't even know what it is. For $9.99, you can get that every month and you have it at your disposal all day, every day, for as long as you want to have access to it. Every month, it's just a monthly fee, and you get access to all that continually. And we're constantly putting stuff on it. I would encourage all of you tonight that can, you need to get that and take it home, particularly if you want to be a student, because it's just a place for you to learn and build a whole repertoire. You know, when I started in ministry, I pastored a small church after I was on the team in a large church. And then I went to a small church to pastor my first church in 1980. And I didn't have but about 35, 40 people. I could call them all in the morning and be in touch to everybody. So I set my heart to digging a well. I read in Psalms 84, it says, when you pass through a valley of Baca, make sure you dig a well, because somebody's going to come behind you that's going to need to drink from it. I used to read 5 books a week. I did that for almost 20 years because I determined I would dig a well. I would listen to my mentors preach. I would read. I would just say, God, I'm digging a well. So I would encourage you, for all of you who want to dig a well tonight, you can take that and find that. It's in the app stores, and you can pull it up and make it a part of your life. I would be honored. I'd be honored to be one of those voices that just continually feeds you and speak to you. Second of all, tonight, can you put these pictures up for me, guys? Of the we just finished this building this past year. It's been finished even further than that. This is a training center in Kampala, Uganda. That building is built, we built this one in the middle of the biggest slum area in Kampala. And go on and show the next slide. It's become so completely finished that the city asked to hold their meeting for all the major leaders and television people from the city. They wanted to hold their banquet there in the building. Go ahead, there's another one. Seats about 1,200 people in the auditorium, but it's a training center because we're planting 40 churches a year. Our goal is to have 40 church planters a year that are going to go into the north of Africa, which is Muslim nations. All of them are Muslim nations, and they're going to go and reach them with the gospel of Jesus. We're going into Somalia and go further into Laos. I mean, and places in the north, and that has been overrun by Islam. Even Nigeria today is being contended for. Nigeria has more millionaires per capita than any nation in Africa. And it's being contended for. They have a Muslim president this now and a Christian vice president. So it's a weird situation, but the nation's being contended for. But we are getting a chance to train pastors and equip people. Tonight I need some people to help me, because I'll tell you, show one more. We got to finish it by putting a fence around it. It takes me about $20,000 to build that fence, and we'll have it completed and be done. We just put in a huge water system on that property that everybody in that slum can come and get water. We supply water for over 15,000 families on that property with the water system we just put in. They get clean drinking water. And our church, my church didn't do this, but this is a project from Tony Miller Ministries, and our network has helped some. But if you'll help me tonight, I just asked the Lord, you know what I asked the Lord for? I said, Lord, I believe there's 50 people in Laurinburg that can sow a $100 seed. Maybe you can't, maybe you can sow 20, maybe you can sow 10, maybe you can sow 1,000. But I just want you to be obedient to the Lord tonight. Will you help me do that? Can you help me get this finished and on its way? I want to contact James Cato, who is our director there, and let him know more money's on the way to him because I've been to Laurinburg. Will you help me sow into their life and make a difference in that nation, that continent, for the glory of God? Here's what I found out. My life was changed by the power of a seed. Mike Murdoch said to me one day, I was many years ago, he and I have been friends for many, many years. He sat down, he said, Tony, the three most important things in your life are the Holy Spirit, to understand your assignment, and to recognize the power of your seed, because your future is always in your present. There's something in your possession that's going to change your future. And it comes to you in seed form. And when you release your seed, God supernaturally causes things to happen. You know what? When I started, I didn't know anybody even have a passport. I didn't have one. Nobody in my family had one. And now, 40 plus years later, 80 nations of the world physically and 160 nations of the world by television. How did that happen? It all started with a seed. It all started with a seed. You take what you have and you invest it, and God begins to multiply. So I'm going to pray tonight. Can we just pray? I don't believe in taking long offerings. I'm just going to pray and ask the Holy Spirit to tell you what to do. And all I'm asking you to do is to obey him. Whatever he says to you, I want you to do that. Pastor, they'll just make the checks out to Lighthouse Nations. Is that okay? And they'll just give me one check together. So if you want to cash, check, I don't know what else you take. They're going to put them on the screen, huh?
Yeah, they'll put the ways up on the screen.
They're going to put all the ways on the screen. I don't even remember all of them anymore, you know. I don't know if you do Cash App, Vimeo, whatever it is. I don't know. But anyway, they'll put them on the screen for you so you'll know how to do that. Father, I'm asking you in the name of Jesus tonight that you will speak to the people. Lord, my heart tonight is to extend your kingdom. So I pray that you'd shine your light now into people's hearts about their giving. I pray, Lord, that so as they've received. And I thank you, Lord, that as they do, you're not mocked. Whatever a man sows, that will he reap. I thank you for cheerful, abundant givers tonight. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Would you let my son, partner, friend, Stephen Ward, know you're glad he's here tonight? I'm grateful that he's here. Pastor? Come on, give it up one more time, Bishop. Have you been impacted tonight?
Hallelujah.
You ready to take on the world?
Yeah.
You ready to be a light in the darkness?
Yes.
I'm the wrong one to hand this to. You could have been anywhere on a Friday night. You chose to be here. And your life will never be the same because of it. Started out as chicken wing ministry and still rolling over in the house. It's an inside joke. I'll be glad to share it with you one day. Bishop, it's been an honor. Beyond an honor. I told him there's very few people that I'll get in a foxhole with. I've always had an issue with trust. Always. And I'm the guy that you could always lean on, but I kept you at a distance. I wouldn't let you get but so close. Because in this business, it's real easy to get hurt. But I'm proud to say I got two of my spiritual fathers in the house, and both of them have taught me an enormous amount about space, grace, and that wonderful thing called mercy. And it may look like hell's going on, but you need to find some folks to get in the foxhole with you.
Yes, sir.
That can help you pull yourself up sometimes when you forget how. And I'm looking at a room full of game changers. You wouldn't be here tonight if it wasn't important to you. So you need to look at yourself in the mirror when you get home and say, self, do it in third person, it don't matter. Say, it's time to line up and be the light that you were created to be. I'm going to try that one more again. I'm going to do it country. You got the super educated one while ago. Say, self. You got to get it together and be the light you were created to be. Tomorrow morning, there'll be a leadership session starting at 10 a.m. sharp. Myself will be here. Bishop T.C. Holmes will be here. And who knows, there might even be a special guest that shows up. But if you hadn't registered, I guess you won't know nothing about that. It will not be broadcast live on Facebook. It will be a very intimate time for leaders. And I know you're thinking, well, I'm not a pastor, I'm not a leader. If you woke up this morning, you have the capabilities of leading someone somewhere. So you are a leader. 10 o'clock in the morning, if you want to come, by all means be here. Just go on our website, lighthousenation.org/register.
If not, I can't feed you. We're going to feed you the word, and then we're going to give you something else to eat on and send you home to tear up your church Sunday. Oh, y'all laughing. I want you to go to your church and tear the sheetrock down. Pastors that traveled from all over, thank you. My heart is jumping out of my chest for you guys, assistant pastors, super leaders. We got folks from Virginia in the house, South Carolina in the house. We just made the kingdom of hell real upset tonight, and I love it. And you. That's my boy right there. I love him more than he knows. The devil's tried to do a lot of stuff this week. It might have took a year the first time. I don't think it'll take that long the next time. I love you guys more than words. I want to pray with you. I want to bless you. Dear gracious Heavenly Father, thank you for the time that you've allowed us to sit in your throne room. Thank you for allowing us to sit under your learning tree tonight, Father. I ask that you begin to stir in us right now, Father, to reveal the light that you've placed in each and every one of us. Your word says we are the light of the world, and to let our light shine. Well, tonight, the world says shine bright like a diamond. But the only way you become a diamond is through pressure. There's a lot of people that's been through a lot of things in here. So I'm looking for that light to be revealed from this day forward and never hide it under a bush. Father, thank you. May you bless us and keep us as we travel. Thank you for your anointing that you poured out here tonight. And I give you the praise, honor, and glory that only a true king deserves. And if that's you tonight, I want you to shout amen. Amen. And give him a hand clap. Amen. Where heaven can hear you tonight. I love you guys. If you want to speak to Bishop, I think he's going to sit there for 34 seconds. So you better hurry up. I love you. Be blessed. Offering, if you actually have a physical offering, there are buckets at the front. Baskets, wood boxes, crates, whatever you want to call them. By all means, sow in. Send them some Go to Loving home music. Amen.